Well, it goes without saying, though, that not only Mamelodi Sundowns fanatics cried a river over the past weekend when the Brazilians got knocked out of the Champions League quarterfinal stage. Now, this is a club that has carried the hopes of the country on their shoulders, and to see them fall short of a semi-final berth was heartbreaking. Lots of hearts were shattered, trust me. Now, one third of the Sundowns co-coaches, Manqoba Mngqithi, joins us to talk about their disappointment and why they'll fallen short at this phase for a third time. But firstly, we need to respect the day that it is today, because it is an important day. A cold foot. Usuku lokuzalwa. Happy birthday, bro.
Thanks, my brother.
How does it feel?
It's worrying when you're getting over 50.
When you're getting over 50.
Yeah.
So it is your birthday today.
Definitely. Happy birthday to you. Happy
birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday
to you. Wow.
Courtesy of Marawa Sports Worldwide. To you, Coach Manqoba Mngqithi. Yeah, boni keke lihle kanje. Let's turn this again, Fikla. You couldn't come here on the day of your birthday and we don't celebrate. Singakunikeza ngisho nama eat some more. That was never going to happen.
No, thank you very much, guys. I really appreciate it. It looks top.
Yeah.
It looks very good.
Or it has, and you play radio's theater of the mind. Abang Aibo Nemakai.
I was good, Kaza, as in Dokuna, no more strawberries. But the good thing is that our logo is all over this cake. I really appreciate to see our logo because it shows the love that one is getting from our beloved club, the support we are getting from the boss, the chairman of the club, the management, the entire technical team, and the players. We're really blessed to be in an environment where you feel the support and the love. And thank you very much to everybody who made it possible for me.
Absolutely. With love from hashtag MSW. We wish you many, many more years to come, coach. And we just wanted to welcome you, to our studios. So many more years. And blessings, please.
Thank you very much, Rob. I really appreciate it. And I really appreciate having me in this beautiful place and a very inspirational environment, I must say.
Thank you so much, Coach. Thank you very, very much indeed. Like I say, if it's a person's birthday and they're reaching many milestones, regardless of what happened over the weekend, we celebrate life because without life, we are nothing. And so begins then the introspection, I would imagine. I kind of threw a question about falling short at the same stage, I think for the third time now. Having had the luxury of time post the game, what have you worked out?
To be honest, the result is still very much hurting. I don't want to lie to you. Considering the performance of the boys on the day, because I honestly think on the day our boys really pitched, and I think the strategy from the technical team after profiling the opposition showed us very good signs, first half in particular, because to create 9 chances in 45 minutes and within that 45 minutes have 2 big chances with opposition not even having one at that time, you really must regret not having won that match, because under normal circumstances in a match, if you get 9, you get 5 chances, maybe 2 big chances, you will appreciate. But in this one, I think we created a lot. Our counter-pressing was good. Our high press frustrated their left side of Kinito and Canelo, the left back. But unfortunately, we we did not take our chances. And in this game, when you don't take your chances, you get punished. It was very unfortunate, I must be honest, not to score a penalty and also not to take the number of chances that we created at that time, because we knew the second half would be very scrappy, because in the Champions League, these time-delaying tactics are always predominant. And worse on this one, I think the VAR also played a very negative role in killing the momentum of the game. I think the stoppages we got in the second half, first when Dennis was arguing that he was fouled by Pinto, and secondly when there was that penalty, which because again our VAR does not have all the camera angles. And it delayed because now it casts a lot of doubt as to whether there was contact or no contact. And they used just one camera angle, which in essence, there was no foul. But unfortunately, it's very difficult because in that space, we must also give credit to the attacker. Because what the attacker did, he decided once he realized that AJ was sliding, he decided to fall on AJ so that it looks like he was hacked. And that for me is brilliance. It's something that even our players can learn from. And we profiled this boy, who number 21, Gleason.
Yeah.
We profiled him because we know he's a very intelligent player, Brazilian by birth, very, very instrumental in tight spaces. And a very, very intelligent player to make decisions like those to make his team to win the match. Because in as much as you can say penalty or not penalty, but the truth of the matter is because there was that foul, and it's not very clear what happens with the leg that was trailing behind from AJ, then it presents an opportunity for the referee to say, hey, I cannot dispute much. I don't have too many angles to really show that what I saw initially, because what the referee saw initially was a dive, but unfortunately could not substantiate, and he's not alone. He's listening to other guys and he's looking at this thing. And the same VAR that has made a lot of very wrong decisions in the Champions League, I must be honest, because the camera angles are not, they do not have as many cameras as it's supposed to be when you are going to have VAR, you know. But that is water under the bridge now. We lost a game that I think second half became very scrappy. And because of this loss of momentum, we must also take a blame as well, that now we started getting disparate. Because when the game starts, and the time, you look at the time, you see, we are losing minutes here and these people are sitting in and they are not coming out. Then you say, maybe let's try with a Pavol inside the box. If we can put few good crosses, we might get something with Pavol and Peter in the box. If you bring in a Lesedi and a Gaston, slightly quicker and nippy, maybe they with a few dribbles, they might be hacked and you get free kicks and penalties in and around the box, so that you are able to get possibilities with Lyle, possibilities with crosses and wing play, because against such a deep-lying defensive block, you need a lot of wing play. But that wing play alone does not help if in the box you don't have presence. Then we had Pavol, we had Peter, but the game lost its taste, I must be honest. The game started to be very scrappy because now, you know, with players, unfortunately, sometimes when you present a possibility of now when you get into the wide channels, if you are in a very good space, look at what is happening. Maybe you might have numerical superiority then and put it. But if it's not clear, you still have a Gaston, you still have a Kapinga, you still have all these other players that are very dynamic to play in that space. So we also brought him in because of the short combination play to try and unsettle them central if they're closing the wide channels. But they were really not closing the wide channels that much. But unfortunately, the quality of the crosses was not at the level that we expected. And that's how we lost the game.
And I appreciate the explanation, though, because, again, getting into the mind of a coach, it's important for us to understand your analysis, because sometimes in a post-match interview directly after the game, you might not have internalized things. And I fully agree. The VAR system hasn't brought much good into the game. What is the point of having VAR if you hardly got a lot of different angles? Because that is what VAR is supposed to do, yeah. Is to provide a video assistance to referees and human errors. But then, just looking at Bamlak Weyesa, the referee that was in charge, you seem to be all over the place, almost seem to be the one taking the shine of the spotlight from the game, and it should never be like that. So we'll come back, maybe get more thoughts around VAR, but also just the application, because I was looking at the stats. Petro Atletico, they only had one shot on target in the entire game. Sundowns had 13 attempts at goal, 3 were on target. You come out to just one goal. So where was it? Where was the dynamic lacking? We'll also take some of your calls. We'll take as well your reaction. So feel free to give us a call. As you know, that it is a Monday. We've brought the coach of Mamelodi Sundowns to be with us in studio. 010-442-6300, 060-708-0484. Don't go anywhere. In conversation tonight on Reaction Monday with coach of Mamelodi Sundowns, Manqoba Mngqithi is with us here in studio. So take advantage of that. It's not every day, but also fresh from a defeat. And I always say, if you man up in the manner in which he's been able to man up, you earn my respect immediately, because it's not only about the glory moments when there's a trophy to be paraded. It's also about coming forward and addressing the nation, taking responsibility and analyzing what could have and what would have gone wrong. Let me pick up on that, what we were just listening to now, Upilane, who was talking about whether or not you do sit down with your strikers, whether it's preseason, and even talking about the 3 opportunities, at least trying to convert one of them. What did you make of that? I know I could see you were listening quite attentively to that.
You know, sometimes I always say when you're a little bit away from something, you don't gather everything that happens within that environment. That's why I'm not a doctor, because I don't know what is happening in the surgery. Mm. So what is happening now with what Pilan is saying? It's out of concern when he sees people not scoring. And you cannot blame him for that, because when you see strikers, the season finishes and our strikers are even struggling to score 15 goals per season, yeah. Which is probably a goal every 2 matches in the league only. So what we need to try maybe to explain to Pilan Kuti, as coaches, our responsibility is to train the striker or train the player to make sure that he's got the tools to deliver what is expected of him at any given time. That is, if he's expected to take a first touch, the first touch is good, and terminate the attack, the shot is good, it does not go astray. But beyond just training the technique, the tactical application, again, that's why we will analyze the opposition and say the opponents are sitting in too much, so we don't have too much space behind their defense, or their goalkeeper comes out quickly behind the defense. Maybe we must be in these angles, like diagonal angles in play, so that we are able to get diagonal dodges, balls that are not going direct to the goalkeeper, so that we can be able to capitalize on the space in the diagonal channels, usually the half spaces or what we call the assist zones. We are able to get balls into that space. Ours is to replicate these pictures in training, because these pictures are the pictures that the player is going to find in a match. And in a match, they may not be as much as you find them in training. In training, we can replicate this maybe for, let's say, 20 situations that you can only find 4 in a match.
Right.
And in those 20 situations, you come out maybe tops out with maybe 7-8 of them. You really do what is expected of you. The receiving technique, the foot that you use, either a back foot or what, in order to put yourself in a better position to be able to terminate an attack. But in a match, they are only going to be 2 to 4 of these situations.
Right.
And this thing then becomes a little bit of a challenge if this striker is expected to do so much only now. He was never expected to do so much when he was playing for the under 13, when he was playing for the other under 15, because these hours of development, they help, because these pictures that get engraved in the mind of the player, just like the pictures of you driving. When you are driving, you start by looking at the gear. Hey, I'm putting number one, I'm putting number two. You know, Guti, you must look at the gear. You can't make that mistake. But as you drive years and years and years, you no longer even look. You know, when this situation presents itself, this is what I do. And as coaches, these visuals always help the player from video analysis and also from training perspectives, where we replicate the type of a defender you are going to be playing against, maybe in a microcycle. But in a preseason training, where we are still just training the overall aspects of the game, we will be looking at all these dynamics and principles of the game, or group, from individual to group to team tactical disciplines, to say, in this situation, this is what is expected. When it's a one against one, this is what you do. That's why if you are a defender, we will always make you aware very early that the opponent that you are playing against is left-footed or right-footed, because we are giving you an edge, so that when you're approaching him, you must know he's most likely to go to his strong foot, and he normally goes to his strong foot. And if we see that this player, in as much he goes to his strong foot, but there are times where he goes to his weaker foot and is dangerous, we will also make you aware. These are the pictures that you must have in your mind as an individual player, as a group. Maybe if it's a high press, the striker, the number 10 and the wingers, depending on the system, the midfielders, or on the side, more especially, let me give an example of the Petro Athletic. We know that they've got a very strong wing play. Fullbacks overlap. Wingers either play double wide or they play out in the half spaces, out of the wing. Strikers are always looking for the space behind your fullback if your fullback opens too early. And that's what we did in Angola. And we improved a lot in the game that we played here at home. We managed to kill possibilities of these crosses. We managed to kill possibilities of them having chances with a very good mentality of a high press and counter presses to make sure that they never get time. That's why they only had one shot on target based on that. But when you've lost the game, everything that was good that you have done does not really count much. People will always say, you are out, it's an excuse. But you look at the number of chances you created, look at all the stats in terms of possession, in terms of the box entries, in terms of shots at goals, counter presses. I mean all these aspects that you are looking at when you are talking about dominating the field and dominating the pitch. Those statistics are the ones that must say you deserve to win the match or you did not deserve to win the match.
Because, I mean, you find somebody who's been scoring ad nauseum these days in Shalulile. He had a chance very early on in the game that he was not able to convert. So in such situations, maybe that's what Pilani was also alluding to, is how do you get to be at your most clinical best? I know it's maybe scientifically not possible all the time to be, but in such high pressure games, in such games where it's all or nothing, you're fighting for the second star, and your star player is also human and doesn't convert as he should. I mean, it was a frustrating day. I mean, I was counting the number of yellow cards that they got. Pedro, it was what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. About 5, at least, I counted. Was that a sign of something? Was it them on the back foot, them being frustrated, them losing the discipline because they were starting to scramble much for the ball?
You can say that, but also some of these fouls are tactical fouls. Yeah. Maybe when they see that you are breaking out, they want to cut that attack in order to make sure that they can regroup again. Yeah. And the sad thing about some of these yellow cards, when Kinito makes a foul in the box that results in a penalty, he does not get a yellow card on Temba's one. And the same Kinito second half holds Temba's one from behind and stops him from a situation that is already beyond the last line of defense. He does not get a yellow card for that instance. But a Lebo Mabua holds a player in the halfway line with a bunch of players behind that could still mean the attack is not that attack that you can say he's stopping a promising attack, but immediately gets a yellow card. At times, even the referees make the game a little bit more difficult for everyone, because now you've got a Lebu that is having a yellow card and he's one of your most important players for counter presses. And now if you can't counter press with the same aggression, the same speed that you expect from him, because now he's already on thin ice because he's got a yellow card. But the truth of the matter is, some of these fouls do not necessarily mean the opposition was under tremendous pressure, but it's just a fear of giving out opportunities and you decide to pull or to stop the game so that you can delay. And you've seen a lot of delays because this stop-start immediately makes that foul there and the referee gives him a yellow card. His teammate is sleeping somewhere. Then the referee must leave the area where the foul happened and go to the other side and check what's happening with that one now. Is pulling hamstring? Is it a cramp or what? When he comes from there, the referee, the ball has been shifted where it was supposed to be. Then the referee must reprimand them. May allow the opponents to start the ball where it's supposed to start. At that moment, something is happening somewhere. And referees are also human. They make these mistakes of not understanding that the goalkeeper, the ball comes out on the left channel, he goes to the right channel, and he throws it on the other side and he walks to it. By the time the referee comes, he puts the ball nicely, and the referee says kick, then he reverses. Then when the referee is there, the goalkeeper is not starting. And it's normal in the Champions League. We can't complain about these things because they happen, they have become normal.
Yeah.
You know, wrong things in Africa, they start by being a norm.
You know,
in the Champions League, they are time-delaying tactics. It's a norm. Then once we accept that it's a norm, then it becomes normal.
But it's a dangerous normal, though, because it plays against the spirit of what football should be. Because then it becomes very, like you say, it becomes that game where you're going to throw yourself on the floor. And it happens with a lot of the North African teams. They see it, they go down. Whatever it is, you leave it to the referee to decide on it. In just a minute before we take another break, the earlier voice note spoke about the very same Temba, saying that the reason, do you regret having substituted him, or what was the thinking behind that substitution?
You know, football is a very strange game, because after a fact, everybody knows what should have happened. You know, they always say hindsight is the best sight, because I always say people who are like that, who rely on hindsight, their teams never get to play the match, because they always know, if you did not put this one and you had put this one, this is what could have happened. But the truth of the matter is, the reason why we brought Ulesedi Kapinga and Gaston second half and Pavol one was to threaten them because they were sitting in. Normally when they are sitting in among opponents, you rely on strong wing play and balls into the box. And when you bring balls into the box, they've got Pinto, 1.9 something, they've got Kinito, 1.9 something, and you've got Peter Shalulile alone in that space, and they are sitting in. So you say, let me put another player that will really make them to think twice, to say, hey, are we coming out or are we staying in? Then when they decide to stay in and you are able to put crosses into the box, you should benefit. I said already, the quality of our crossing on the day was terrible, to be honest. Then you bring a Lesedi Kapinga and a Gaston, because you want their mobility, their speed. They are slightly quicker than Tembazwane. So naturally, with their dribbles and speed, they are likely to be fouled more.
Right.
And when they are fouled more in and around the box, or they penetrate. Kapinga had a very good chance on the left channel where he managed to come to his left foot, but unfortunately the ball went wide. If he had decided to take it from the right foot to the left foot, but hold it with the left foot, I can guarantee you the right back was going to foul him. It's a penalty.
Yeah, yeah.
Because of his nippiness. Castron was unfortunate with that touch, Kapavol. I think he had made a very good run beyond the defense from that diagonal ball. And unfortunately, that touch disturbed him a little bit. But
talk about disturbing, coach. Let me disturb your thought pattern. I have to take a break. We'll come back and we'll pick up on these and other related questions. The birthday boy is in studio, Manqoba Mngqithi, as we analyze what happened over the weekend. And as he says, and he admits, though, it still hurts, the defeat. Don't go anywhere. The aim, I think, today would have been to be able to give the coach as much time to elaborate on certain aspects. I think sometimes we learn from listening as opposed to imposing an opinion on something. And I think today that is the main driver of the conversation, is to allow the coach to unpack for us what has happened. Maybe let me tackle the one voice note that talked about, you know, the trio of coaches that, I think it was Edgar saying that you've been lucky because of the quality of the players that you have at your disposal. Yeah, so you talked about Zwane of Chiefs. We'll leave that one there. But do you find yourself as lucky as what he says you are?
No, but to be honest, we must accept that. We are fortunate to be working for a club that has got all the resources that we have and the players that we have. We've got a very good team. But I don't think we are the first coaches to coach Sundowns that has got so many good players. Almost every coach who has coached Sundowns has been exposed to the resources and the talent that the team has. And our responsibility is to drive the team and make sure that the team achieves more than what we have achieved now. And I honestly don't think we have all achieved as coaches, all achieved what the team is capable of, because when you look at the Champions League, we've been out of the quarterfinals three times now in a row, and that does not feel good. We can say whatever in terms of how we have performed, and but where are we now? The truth is, we are out of the Champions League, and everybody will say we wanted to beat Al Ahly. We wanted to win matches in order to qualify for the quarterfinal, and we qualified for the quarterfinals, and we gave a very good fight in the quarterfinals. The same thing that every other coach has fought for, to make sure that we pull ourselves through. And to say a team that created so many clear-cut opportunities and fought and made the opponents to only have one shot at goal, they never showed that they wanted to win the match. I think that is very unfair, because we were playing against a very good team, a team that probably has the resources that Sundowns also has in terms of bringing players from Europe with vast experience, Pinto from Portugal, Suarez from Brazil, Gleason from Brazil, Azulao, Thiago, the striker number 26 from Brazil. It's a team that we must also respect a little bit. And we managed to keep that team quiet. A team that is a very dominant force in Africa. And for people who are talking, because we don't follow football that much, it's the same team that was in the semifinals in the last 3 years. And it's a good team. We must have that bit of respect. We are also a good team, and we deserved to go through. With all said and done, we played better than them. We did a lot of good things. But unfortunately in football, with everything done, you may be out. You look at Italy, for instance. They are not in the World Cup. With 33 shots at goals, with opposition only having 3. But because football is football, and at times football, it's like there's predestination theory that says, this match, no matter what you do, you might not win. And I'm not making an excuse, but I believe, and even today, I'm still very proud of the coaching staff that I have. I'm still very proud of the team that we are working with, because the boys have fought very hard. And Honestly speaking, we are on, I think, on our game 47 for the season. And the intensity of the game was good. The numbers are proving that the boys worked very hard. Structurally, we gave the opposition only one opportunity. And even that opportunity that we gave them, to be honest, it was neither here nor there. You know, I do believe that had AJ gone with Gleason all the way without making a tackle, we would be talking a different language now, because the game became scrappy immediately after that penalty that delayed the game for so long with VAR. And honestly speaking, that penalty should not have been there. With a lot of camera angles, even there, we know for a fact that AJ did not foul the guy, because we look at these things very closely. But the truth of the matter is, now that you are out because of a VAR decision that also took your goal away from home, which was a very legitimate goal, now everybody has got to say these boys did not show that they wanted to play, or the capacity of the coaching staff was not good enough. I think that is very unfair and very vindictive as South Africans. We must try to have a little bit of fairness and look at the game. If when we are emotional, we all think we must just win. But look at the game and say, really, really, first half, we could have easily scored 5 goals. And one of our key players, Upeta, got very good chances on the day and unfortunately did not score. And suddenly, now that he did not score that day, we must crucify him and start to think he's not good enough. That will be very bad. Tembazwane misses a penalty. He has scored some penalties. He has missed some penalties. Now that we have missed a penalty that could have put us head and shoulders over Petro, now we must say Tembazwane is useless because he missed a penalty. That is very, very unfair. So in football, when we are in this game, you must understand, and it's a painful truth, this game you either win, you either draw, you either lose. And this time around, we did not lose, we drew. But the draw was not enough to take us through. Had we converted the chances we got, because statistics show that. When you say the boys never showed that they wanted to win the match and these boys were putting crosses now and again, where did those crosses go to? Because these guys, the statistics are clear. These guys only had one chance on the match, which proves that these boys fought very hard. And I just feel we must just keep supporting. If we are in this game, for the love of it and the understanding of it, we must understand that in some matches you will do so much but still not win. And I would not want to crucify my boys for that. I'm unhappy, I'm hurt, because I still believe even today that we deserve to win the match. And I do not blame anything in terms of the preparation. And at the moment, crying over that spilled milk does not help me. As a coach, I must say, on Wednesday we are playing Cape Town City. We have a responsibility to win the trophy. We have a responsibility to win the Nedbank Cup. It's not all lost. We have a responsibility as coaches to live up to our expectations and achieve what we can achieve. But respect the game. Understand that the game one day will make you happy and the other day can make you very unhappy. And at this stage, I am one of those very unhappy people as well. Mm.